Hey, good morning, everybody. If you're a guest here today, my name's Wes. I'm one of the pastors here. What a great day to be in worship, wouldn't you agree? Oh, it's good. It's good. You can clap. It's okay. If we're going to do it, let's do it. It's a good day to be in worship, right? It is good. It is good. Yeah. I saw some fist pumps in the back. Ooh, they got you fired up, right? You're ready to break out into some rap, I suppose. But one of my favorite memories when I was the age of some of the kids up here was around Christmas time going to my papaw's house. My papaw Lewis was a great guy, one of the mentors in my life. He loved Jesus. He loved us. And I was his firstborn grandson. So that means, you know, I was the guy. I was the baby, right? Some of you grandparents know what I'm talking about. You guys are insane, by the way, grandparents. Don't get them started. Don't ask a grandparent about a story. You're going to be there all day if they're talking about their grandkids. But I was that kid for my Papaw Lewis. And so I love hanging out with him, fishing with him, hunting with him. He'd tell me stories about World War II. It was great. But the best thing was he loved Jesus and taught me a lot about what it means to be a follower of Jesus. So we went to his house at Christmas. It was great. Now, Papaw was disabled. He was a painter by trade, but he became disabled. And so he didn't have a whole lot of money. In fact, one of our outings one time was to go and stand in the government cheese truck line. I mean, that's how poor he was, right? And so one Christmas, though, we went and we were opening our presents. My little brother was there, and I opened up my papaw's present, and guess what it was? It was a pack of gum. Now, I thought in my mind, did I say this out loud? Like, Papaw, I know you're poor, but a pack of gum, really? I mean, come on, you know, I'm your firstborn grandson. I mean, you know, a pack of gum, really? But my brother, meanwhile, he wasn't thinking about that. He tore into the present. He started unwrapping the gum, and guess what he found? One stick of gum was wrapped with a dollar bill. Aha, and so was the next one, and so was the next one, and so was the next one. And by the time my brother was done, he found $5 that my papaw had surgically placed inside the gum wrapper. Now, I was digging into mine, of course, and our other cousins, they were doing the same thing. And the next year, we came back, and Papaw gave us a pair of socks. And I thought, oh, no, this is a time for despair. But guess what? I reached inside the sock, and I found $5. Now, $5 as a kid, that's like $1 million, right? And so that's what I found. This was great. The next Christmas, my uncle remarried, and two new cousins joined us, my step-cousins, and they joined us, and we opened up that year's box, and it was a box of walnuts. Now, my new cousins, they looked at me, and they're like, okay, what's the deal here with this family? You know, we get walnuts for Christmas. I said, keep the faith, boys. We need to open these walnuts before we complain. And we did. We tore it. And Papaw had surgically placed money inside these walnuts. It was from my Papaw Lewis at each of these Christmas gatherings throughout my life that I learned that great things come in unexpected packages, right? So it is with Christmas, the same thing. This wonderful thing, this treasure that goes beyond words, comes to us in the most unexpected passage. Look with me as our anchor verse for this series affirms this. Galatians 4:4. Let's read it out loud. Here we go. When the time was just right, God sent his son, born a virgin. Let that one sink in for a moment. Okay, this is unexpected, wouldn't you agree? Yeah, God's going to come to earth. Okay, how's he going to do it? Be born of a virgin. Okay, I'm not sure about all this, especially if you're Joseph, right? Can you imagine being engaged to Mary? And she comes and says, hey, guess what? I'm pregnant. Good news. Yeah, God told me it's good news. He's like, I don't think it's good, right? I mean, seriously, I've done a lot of marriage counseling, premarital counseling. Right? And this will be a tough one to overcome. You know, if they came and sat in my office, sat out on the couch and said, you know, we want you to our wedding. She's pregnant. It's by the Holy Spirit. But anyway, she's pregnant. And so imagine what Joseph's going through. Imagine this poor guy. And he's trying to figure out what's going on. I know he's a good guy, though, because he resolves in his mind that he is not going to shame her. He doesn't let his wound her. So he's an incredible guy. And I'm sure he's still wrestling with this when he falls asleep one night. And the law says that he could stone her for adultery, but love told Joseph to protect her. And yet I'm sure he's wrestling with this decision as he falls asleep. Matthew gives us an account of what takes place. Look with me at Matthew 1, verses 20, 21. Imagine in your mind's eye, Joseph going to bed. I'm sure he's tossing and turning. Eventually he falls asleep out of exhaustion. And as he's considering all this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. Joseph, son of David, the angel said, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, For the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. Read the rest with me. And she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Now, this is an important message, wouldn't you agree? And don't you like that the angels, they always start with this greeting most of the time in Scripture, right? Hey, their greeting is not hello, it's don't be afraid. That's hello in angel, okay? If you want to know how to speak angel, it starts with do not be afraid. And that's what the angel says to Joseph. I'm sure he's like, okay, and here comes the news. It's true. It's true, Joseph. Don't worry. It's true. But then comes the assignment. Do you see the assignment? What is Joseph supposed to do? What's his responsibility in this whole story, this amazing drama unfolding before our very eyes? And we know the end of the story. So imagine Joseph. His assignment's to do what? To name the child Jesus. Now, what's in a name? Well, the name Jesus, there's plenty in this name. That was a common name. It comes from the Hebrew name Joshua. Joshua was a huge person in biblical history. He took over from Moses, led God's people to the promised land. That's an important name. But the word Jesus means God's help or God's salvation. And this is affirmed in what the angel says. For read that last line with me again. For he will what? Save his people from their sins. So this is a description of all of Jesus's ministry, right? All that Jesus is going to do is contained in his name. And Joseph, thank goodness Joseph names Jesus, Jesus, because Jesus means that there is a Savior that has arrived on the scene. Aren't you glad that there is a Savior who has come to earth and his name is Christ Jesus the Lord? Aren't you glad? Oh, come on. Have you read the news? Yes, I'm glad. Have you checked your phone lately? Have you seen what's happening on Twitter? Have you watched the nightly news? Have you picked up a newspaper and you seen all that's going on in our world? Oh, boy. This week, I was watching the news, and I honestly just started to get filled with despair. Am I alone? I just thought, whoa, things are bad. Things are bad. And in my despair, I went to the Lord in prayer, and I was like, God, you know, what's going on here? And the Lord reminded me that there is a deliverer who has come. Our deliverer is coming. Our deliverer is not going to leave us as orphans. He is going to come to us. He has come to us. His name is Jesus, God with us, Emmanuel, God's helper, God's salvation has come. And oh, do we need a Savior? Do we need a Savior on this in this world? Do I need a Savior in my life? Because when I get done watching the news, you know what happens? Sometimes I get and go, I look in the mirror. And I think about my life, and I think how, no wonder the world's such a messed up place, because I'm such a messed up person, and I'm part of this equation, part of this planet Earth, and so are you. We need a Savior, wouldn't you agree? And the Lord says to Joseph, hey, name that boy Jesus, because he's going to save the world from our sins. That's good news. That's a reason to celebrate. That's a reason to shout it from the mountaintops, as our kids said, because Jesus comes to reconcile us to God. Reconcile us to one another. Yes, we'll get to that. But to reconcile us to God, what does that mean? To reconcile means to establish friendly relationships again where there was previously hostility, where there was previously distance. And you know from just your own life that there's a great difference between you and me and God, right? I don't have to spend a whole lot of time trying to convince us of that. That's why actually I'm here. I know that full well. And there's a holy God, and then there's me. And there's a big old divide, like Grand Canyon-esque. And Jesus comes along as our reconciler, and he stretches out his arms upon a cross. And Jesus becomes a bridge over troubled waters for us. He lays down his life so that we might be able to be in a relationship with God once again. Jesus reconciles us to God. We need a reconciler, don't you agree? We need to be able to have a relationship with God. And when Jesus comes, he wants to change our life, and indeed he wants to change the world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. That's the good news. And it's good news that we're desperate for. And here's the question we're going to take a look at this morning is how can I join Jesus in changing everything in this world? Everything needs changing, wouldn't you agree? But we're not just to be passive spectators. We don't just pop microwave popcorn, sit down and say, okay, have at it, Jesus. I'm going to watch for a little bit while you change everything. No, he wants to invite us to be a part of this, as we will see. So to answer this question, we took a look at a passage of Scripture from 2 Corinthians. We're going to look at it together. And here's the first fill in the blank. We need to join Jesus in this ministry of reconciliation. How do we do it? First, receive Jesus' ministry of reconciliation. The first move is for you and I to receive. That's how we can be a part of Jesus' work in changing this world through this thing called reconciliation. We're singing a lot of Christmas carols these days. You remember the Christmas carol, Hark the Herald Angels Sing? It says, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners, what? Reconciled. There's that word, right? God and sinners, we need to be reconciled. We need to be brought close to God again. Who needs reconciliation? You and I do, right? This week I came across a letter that a little kid wrote to Santa Claus. Here's how his letter went. Dear Santa, there are three boys that live in this house. There's Jeffrey, he's 2. There's David, he's 4. Then there's Norman, he's 7. Jeffrey is good some of the time. David is good most of the time. But Norman is good all the time. I am Norman. Santa Claus, remember that when you come to visit our house this Christmas. Now, friend, if you've made it to church this morning and during this whole year, this whole Advent season, frankly, this whole day, you've made it and you're good all the time and you know it, then you might just want to take a nap for the rest of this message series. And then I'd invite you to join us for Celebrate Recovery on Friday night. So you can take a nap, join in on Friday night. We'll have a group just for you, and we'll deal with the topic of denial. However, if you come today and you know that you're not good even some of the time, and at best, you know, maybe most of the time, but you know that there's a real need in your life to be connected to God, and you and God are chasms apart, well, then you've come to the right place, for Jesus saves. Jesus has come to reconcile us, and when the Apostle Paul sits down to write a letter to some early followers of Jesus, he has had his life transformed. He has received Jesus' ministry of reconciliation. And so he wants to encourage other folks to receive this grace in their life. Now, the Apostle Paul, you got to remember, this guy used to stand by. We meet him in the book of Acts. He stands by as a follower of Jesus is murdered. A guy named Stephen. He's the first Christian martyr, and his life is taken, and this guy, Paul, who was then named Saul, is standing by watching this whole thing go down. And then he grows up, I guess, and becomes a full-fledged persecutor of Christians. He was a terrorist. The name Saul would send people into a panic if you're a follower of Jesus in those days, because he was coming to hunt you down, take you to jail, or worse. And so Paul and his friends, they've had their life completely transformed. Jesus appears to Paul, when he's riding on top of a high horse on his way to persecute Christians, and Jesus knocks him down, blinds him for a few days, and then he is able to see with new eyes. Scales fall off of this guy's eyes. He's renamed Paul, and he writes a letter saying that his life is now controlled by Jesus' love. Controlled. Who's controlling your life? Who's controlling your life? Many of us think we can control our own life. We do it our way, right? We'll do it our way. And that's what Paul says. That's not the way I live anymore. I don't want to control my own life. In the King James Version, he says, God's love constraineth me. Everybody say constraineth. Straineth, yeah. God's love controls me. God love constraineth me. Sometimes I need God's love to constraineth my mouth. Am I alone? I need God's love to constraineth my behavior. I need God's love to constraineth my mind. Because my mind's a dangerous neighborhood. You don't want to go there alone at night. It's dangerous in there. I need a Savior to come and control me like Paul. I need a Savior to come along and by His grace even constraineth me. And so this is what's happened. This is what he's writing about when he says these words in 2 Corinthians. Look with me at the passage that's on the screen. It's also in your notes. He says, so we have stopped evaluating others from a human point of view. At one time, he says, we thought of Christ merely from a human point of view. How differently we know him now. Read the rest with me. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. All of this is a gift from God who brought us back to himself through Christ. You see, God and sinners are reconciled, brought back together through the gift that Jesus gives us when he dies upon a cross for our sins and is raised to new life. So you and I can be, did you see those words? It's right there. The old life is what? The old life is what? Gone. And the new life has begun. Let me explain it this way. My mom was a kindergarten teacher for 25 years. My brother and I used to tease her, Mom, are you ever going to get out of kindergarten? And the answer was no. She saw her teaching career as a ministry, and she loved those kids and reached out to them and changed their life, I believe. One of her students was a kid by the name of Raekwon. And Raekwon was having trouble in her class, and she prayed for him, and she would tell us to pray for him. And eventually, the grace of God got a hold of Raekwon, and his life was transformed. He even got some awards at the end of the school year. Raekwon did well. Well, when Raekwon was in the third grade, he kind of slipped back to his old ways. And so Mrs. Morris, his third grade teacher, sent him back down to my mom's class as a punishment. Raekwon, you go down to the kindergarten class. Miss Olds will have you in her room for a little while. I'm tired of you, right? That's a tough punishment. So Raekwon gets in the class with my mom. My mom sits him down in the corner and says, Raekwon, why don't you write a letter to your teacher, Miss Morris, and tell her what's going on. Here's what he wrote. Dear Mrs. Morris, I want to tell you about the old and the new Raekwon. The old Raekwon is bad, doesn't listen to the teacher. But the new Raekwon is nice and listens. He is kind and shares. The new Raekwon is very loving. Mrs. Morris, he said, I want to be the new Raekwon. I don't know why you came to worship today, but I came because I want to be the new Wes. I want to be the new Wes, the Wes that God speaks of and talks of in the scriptures. I know the old Wes. I don't like him. You don't like him either. Nobody seems to like the old Wes, including me. But God loves me and you and wants to make us brand new. This is a gift. This is a gift to receive. You can't earn this. You can't work your way into righteousness. Listen, if anybody's given it a shot, it's me, okay? You can ask Pastor George. I've known him for 30 years. He was my youth pastor. I've tried to be holy enough. That never works. I've tried to gain God's approval and God's favor. It never works. I've tried to work my way and try my way and sweat and strive my way, and it never works. What can wash away my sin? Here's what I've discovered, friends. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing. That's why I'm so glad Joseph listened to the angel. For Jesus saves. He saves us. And you and I, we know that we need a Savior today. We need a Savior to come and with His grace to control our life, to take control. We need God's grace to come and constraineth us to take control of our life. Let me ask you, how are you viewing Christ these days at Christmas time? Paul says we no longer look at Christ from a human point of view. Human point of view, I mean, Jesus, it's about Jesus. Okay, that's good. Yeah, it's about Jesus. We'll go to the mall, buy some presents. That's what Christmas is, right? But for those of us who know that He is our Savior, Jesus and Christmas, this is so much more, right? This is the time of year we give ourselves to Him anew, or maybe for the first time for you, to just simply say, Jesus, I want to receive your gift of grace today. I give up trying it my own way. I'm tired. I need your help. I need your grace and forgiveness. That's a simple prayer, and it's just available for you today. You can pray that prayer. First, we need to receive. That's how Jesus is going to use us to change the world. I know it seems counterintuitive, but look with me at number two. Because once we've received God's grace, then guess what? We can give Jesus' ministry of reconciliation to others. So many of us try to run out the door and go try to help other people when we haven't been helped ourselves. We can't express God's grace until we've experienced God's grace through Jesus Christ. We've got to Not give and receive, as people talk about this time of year. Oh, it's about giving and receiving, right? You've heard that before. Well, what the message of the gospel is, it's about receiving, then giving. Receive, then give. You see, all that effort you've put forth trying to be holy enough or good enough or righteous enough, now you can use that effort to be, well, let's look with what Paul says about this, to be his representative. Here's what Paul says, and God has given us the task of reconciling people to him, for God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them, and he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. Read the rest with me of this slide. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. I'll take it from here. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ. As God's, what's that word? Partners. We beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. For God says, read it with me, at just the right time, I heard you. On the day of salvation, I helped you. Indeed, the right time is now. Today is the day of salvation. Now circle that and hold on to that for a moment, because I want us to not miss the fact that Paul says to us that we are Christ's ambassadors. Ambassadors. Now, I've never met an ambassador. I got close once. I was in Nicaragua, and the college kid that picked our team up from Grace Church at the airport, we were chatting with her as we're driving, and she's taking us in a little van to our next destination. Somebody said, well, what brings you to Nicaragua? Why are you here? She goes, oh, well, my dad's the United States ambassador to Nicaragua. That's why I'm here. And I was in the back of the van thinking, cool, this is cool. Like she's like knows somebody who knows somebody that, you know, it's like famous. I want to know more about what this is like. This is a pretty big responsibility, wouldn't you think, to be an ambassador of the United States in another land? I mean, that would be quite the job and quite the job description. Paul says to us, listen to me, we are Christ's ambassadors in this land, in Cape Coral, Florida. In Lee County, Florida, he is dispatching hundreds and thousands of ambassadors to go and represent his interests in this planet and in these people that surround us. You are Christ's ambassador. Wow! That's quite a title, right? You could put that on a business card. Just carry it around. Somebody asks for your phone number, you just hand them a card. Christ's ambassador. Wow, that's something. Yeah, it'd be hard to live into, right? And some of us are afraid that we can't, but this comes by grace. Do you catch it? You don't have to wait until you're perfect enough or holy enough. Jesus took care of that. Amen? So a guy named Sam has done this week. Sam's part of our teaching team, and he tells us a story that when he was going to a store, he saw a guy that was sitting there, and this guy needed some food. Sam quietly went and got him some food, took him the food, and you know, it was nice and quiet, chatted with the guy for a minute, and as Sam was leaving, an observer had been watching this whole thing in the store and came up to Sam and said, you know what, the world needs more people like you. And Sam said, no, actually, the world needs more people like Jesus, and I'm his representative. I'm his ambassador. That's what I'm talking about. You catching this? Simple things. It's what Chris Jackson did this week. You know, the racetrack near our central campus, our central Fort Myers campus, the racetrack right around the corner has been robbed 4 times recently there. And so Chris heard about this. And so Chris went into the store, found the general manager, and said, hey, I just came by to pray for you. And right there in the store, the guy said, well, sure, you can pray for us. We've been robbed 4 times. Chris, like, I know. So they prayed together. All the employees are there. All the customers are there. They stopped for a moment. In fact, after they prayed, the general manager and Chris started talking, and the employees of Racetrack are going to be taking a Wednesday night dinner to our central campus right before the worship service. That's pretty cool, isn't it? That's pretty good. That's good stuff. Yeah. Why is that such good news? Well, because somebody came into their store not to steal, but to share the love of Jesus. That's why this is such good news. And there's something inside of your soul that's going right now. Yeah, that's right. That's right. What is that? It's that darkness can't drive out darkness. Only light can do that. And you hear the call of the Spirit. Go be my ambassadors. Take my love and light everywhere that you can. We heard the kids just say it. I will go and what? Tell it. I will shout it from the mountaintop This is our charge. This is our task. You are Christ's ambassador. I am Christ's ambassador. Paul says, don't ignore this gift. What would have happened? If I'd have taken my papa's present and just thrown it away, year after year, show up at papa's house, walnuts, well, thanks a lot, right? Toss, right? Socks, who wants socks? Throw it away. What would happen? Well, that would be just unthinkable, right? Be unthinkable, and I would have missed out on the grace that my papa was trying to show me. What we're talking about today is receiving first. And once you've received, to go and give this gift of God's love and this ministry of reconciliation to others. And don't miss it today, friends. Paul says today is the day of salvation. Which day? Is it tomorrow? Is it December 31st? Is that the day? No, it's what day? Today. Today is the day of salvation. Don't miss it. Don't ignore it. Don't put it off till tomorrow. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day to receive God's grace in your life. Today is the day. Right now is the time. This present moment is God's present for you and his gift for you. His grace is available for you right now. And friends, Jesus says to you and me, he says, if you're tired and worn out on religion, come to me. I'll give you rest. He says, if you're hungry and thirsty for righteousness, come to me and I will fill you up so that you're finally satisfied. If you're like Zacchaeus and you've climbed atop a materialistic ladder only to find yourself lonely atop of the tree, Jesus says to you, can you hear it inside of your soul? He says, come on down, I want to be a guest in your house today, for today is the day of salvation. If you're like Lazarus and you're trapped in a tomb of darkness and death, then hear the voice of Jesus calling you out of the grave, saying, unwrap him, let them loose, for I am the resurrection and I am life. This is the Christmas that changes everything, because Jesus saves. Jesus saves souls. You ever been saved before? You ever been saved? A doctor by the name of Layman Gray saved my life. I had a diseased aortic heart valve. I was told I had 6 months to live. I was in my 20s, and I thought, okay, what are we going to do now? I don't want to have surgery. And the doctor said, well, you're going to die. I said, when can we have surgery? I'm interested now. And Layman Gray saved my life. Dr. Layman Gray. I carry his name around in a little card in my wallet. Anytime somebody talks about having a good doctor, I take out my card. I'm like, I got the best doctor. His name, Dr. Gray. He saved my life. I think about him with every heartbeat. I think about him with every breath, because it's all a gift from this guy. You ever been saved before? Because Jesus saves. That's what I'm talking about today. Jesus saves not our mortal bodies for a time. He saves souls. Your soul, it's the real you. Your soul is the real me. It's that part of you that lives on into eternity. And God has come and sent Jesus to save your soul. And when you welcome him into your soul today, then you're going to want to start carrying his name around with you everywhere you go. When you receive this, you'll want to give this gift. You'll think with every breath and with every heartbeat, you'll thank Jesus for what he's done in your life. And you'll spread that news. Let's go and share it. Let's go and shout it from the mountaintop. Receive this gift of reconciliation. Give this gift. For this can be the Christmas that changes everything for you and for this world. Let's stand for prayer. Lord, we begin to respond to your word by admitting that we need you. We need you to come and take control. You to come and constrain us. Your grace to invade our life. For many of us are far from you, and we know that you want to bring us back home again. And so we ask that you would do that right now. For those of us who've received, Lord, help us to have the courage to give this grace, to be your ambassador. Empower us, help us, speak to us now as we admit our need to you in song and in prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.